everyone. Wonderful to see you all here. Welcome to the Brooklyn Rails new social environment. We are thrilled to be celebrating our 500th episode today. So thank you all for joining us today and over the past 2 years to make this day possible. I'm Eleanor, an events assistant here at The Rail, and I have the pleasure and privilege of being your MC today for a conversation featuring Sam Messer and Jonathan T.D. Neal. We are thrilled to welcome poet Hannah Lamb Vines here to close today's program. Before we get started, the Brooklyn Rail acknowledges Black Lives Matter, and that here in New York, we are on Lenape Hoking, the unceded land and waters of the Wappinger, Canarsie, Munsee, and Lenape people of the Delaware Nation and Shinnecock Indian Nation. We encourage you to check the chat in just a moment for a living document of resources and actions. Over the past 22 years, the Brooklyn Rail has undertaken a miraculous journey, bringing together in a single monthly publication art, music, dance, film, theater, and literature, along with thoughtful social and political meditations. As a small nonprofit, we need your support, and your contribution will directly support our writers, guest artists, production staff, and all of our operations here at The Rail. Please check the chat for more information and links to donate. And now to introduce today's guest and host. Artist Sam Messer received a B.F.A. from Cooper Union in 1976 and an M.F.A. from Yale University in 1982. He is represented by Nielsen Gallery Boston and Shoshana Wayne Gallery Los Angeles. Messer has received awards.
That's not true, but okay.
Messer has received awards, including a Louis Comfort Tiffany Foundation grant in 1984, the Engelhard Award in 1985, a Pollock-Krasner Foundation grant in 1993, and a Guggenheim Fellowship in 1996. He was appointed senior critic at Yale in 1994, and in 2005 was appointed associate dean and professor. He also serves as director of the art division of the Yale Summer School of Music and Art in Norfolk. Our host, Jonathan T.D. Neal, is associate provost for academic affairs and strategic initiatives, as well as associate professor of art business and arts management at Claremont Graduate University. Since 2010, Jonathan has served in various editorial roles, most recently as contributing editor for Art Review magazine. From 2011 to 2016, he was editor of the Held Essays on Visual Art for the Brooklyn Rail. And from 2008 until 2014, he was executive editor at the Drawing Center in New York City. And I will pass the mic over to you, Jonathan. Thank you so much, everyone.
Thank you, Eleanor. And thank you, Nick, and our poet today, Hannah. And the whole team at The Rail, and Fong Bui in particular, for everything that The Rail is and continues to be for the arts and cultural community, not just in New York, but now nationally and globally. And thank you all for joining us today on what I don't hesitate to say is a remarkable milestone occasion of 500 new social environments. Convenings, conversations, and celebrations of the arts. It's quite a remarkable achievement. And so our hats off to The Rail and its intrepid staff and talent and writers and editors and everybody who puts a lot of effort into what The Rail does. It's a real honor and great privilege to be here, not least because I get to talk to my new friend, Sam Messer. Sam and I did not know each other until 96 hours ago, Sam, when I had the great pleasure of meeting Sam in person and seen his fantastic show of new work at M&B Gallery here in Los Angeles. And so, Sam, it's a great pleasure to be able to do this with you, and I'm very happy that the rail has brought us together to have this conversation. Could we move to, well, Sam, first, do you want to say, I'll give it to you to say hello briefly.
Yeah, I'm really honored to be part of this with the rail. I mean, I've known Fong for years, and I'm a big admirer of just what the rail has done and what it wants to do and what it continues to do is to really to make a community. And in that, my whole life has been made through meeting people. And so meeting you, Jonathan, has actually been a real joy in the last couple of days too. So
I appreciate that. Let's
move on.
We're gonna move right to the work. So Go To It Laughing is the show that Sam has up at M&B Gallery here in LA. And Sam, I want to ask you just to briefly take us through the genesis of this show, and then we will talk a little bit in depth too about specific works. But give us a little context for Go To It Laughing.
Okay, so Go To It Laughing comes from a quote from Melville, which is, I may not know all that is coming, but be what it may be, I'll go to it laughing. And I've been making paintings of the typewriter for over 20 years now. And I think that in this show particularly, I think if anyone looks at them, they realize, you know, they can see the form, but I think intuitively they understand that it just starts to speak to the moment that we're in. At least hopefully that's my goal, right? Where things are hard to put language together, hard to communicate, hard to, you know, things are breaking down, yet we're trying to maintain something. So that's where these works really are located. For me, they're also, and we'll get into this, Jonathan, about what it means to make work today, or how one makes work, or why one makes work. And also, you know, if you think about that Melville quote, which is from Moby Dick, what it means to have subtext in work, right? So the typewriters for me are really, they're just the surface, you know, and a way to talk about more. So maybe we could go to the close-up of It's Perfect here.
Yeah.
So I'll just talk briefly about this painting, which is, as one can see, it's a diptych, and the top part is supposed to be located in clarity in the world that we're in. And then the horizon line, which I used for the diptych, starts to give another layer, right? So we're moving below the world. You know, like 40 years ago, I used to paint fish as still life objects, and I really always thought about the fish as this being that actually thought the entire universe was fine and everything, it knew everything, except when it jumped out of the water or was pulled out of the water, it realized there was this whole other existence. And so when we go back to looking at Jonathan in front of this image, which he's very technical, he can do that. You can see he's in the bottom part, which to me is really the part that world we're living in today, where those keys, the ability to talk is dissolved, they maybe turn into drugs. We're swimming, there's an opening. I'm also very much into the history of painting. So there's another space, it's very Byzantine. I think of El Greco a lot, moving into that space. But maybe we could show the animation and then.
Yeah, let's move to the animation, Nick.
So this animation, which we're gonna show, is made up of about 50 plein air paintings that were specifically located in Ocean Park, California, which is a part of Santa Monica, between Pico, Rose, the beach, and Lincoln Boulevard. I lived there for about 20 years. Also, when I started making these paintings last year in California, when I first got out there, I saw a show by Sarah Fox, whose work I really admire, and I was talking to her about how I realized they were made in New York. And so I started really thinking about when I lived in California, the difference between my work then and my work now in New York. So I started going out and making these paintings at the same time that I was making the other paintings in the studio. All the paintings in the show were made in the studio. All these paintings were made just walking around outside with not even an easel. I just sat down and made them. Oh, no.
That's great. Yeah, round of applause.
Okay, I've lost everyone, though.
Are you back?
I don't know. Oh, yeah, now I'm back. Okay.
Thanks for that. So one of the things I wanted to ask about the just that animation. So, I mean, first, why the Beach Boys as the musical overlay?
So to me, the Beach Boys were actually the perfect song. First of all, it's Don't Worry, Baby. Yep. And that piece, like, it's perfect here. You know, when I'm in Santa Monica, one can be lulled into thinking the world is perfect. And the world clearly is not perfect. And that Beach Boys song, and also just the history of Brian Wilson, right? The whole, you know, so I just think that it has that immediate thing, which is everything is so good, which of course makes me immediately anxious. So, and it's also just the quintessential beach song, right? And those paintings were made at the beach. The other person that I'll just say that I thought about and in the middle of that animation is Diebenkorn's studio building, which is also Sam Francis's studio building. And so while I was making those, I really started thinking about his, you know, his paintings. And I thought about light and shadow and color and really air and temperature. So they, and in doing those, I really had to make sure that those maintained in the paintings that are in the show.
Now I got a question about in the animation. I was struck, I watched it a few times. Mm-hmm. It begins with the lifeguard stands, moves into sort of more quotidian images of the urban landscape. But you mentioned earlier about the diptych from It's Perfect Here and the horizon line. And in the animation, there were only a couple of the plein air works that actually address that horizon line directly. And it's sort of curious to me that even when you go out and you're doing plein air work and you find yourself on the beach, and if there's one place where the horizon would seem to want to assert itself like very dramatically, you've turned 90 degrees and you're facing these lifeguard stands and painting them from the front and from the side. So tell us a little bit about this sort of a little bit more about this relationship to the horizon, and especially in Santa Monica sometimes, where even though you have this, you've got the ocean and you've got the water's edge and you've got this littoral zone, but as soon as you come in a little bit, the horizon is almost completely diminished, right? I mean, from the urban landscape. So how are you trying to navigate when you were out painting out in the world?
So when I'm out in the world, you know, years ago I was walking, I think I was another part of the world, and I was all of a sudden I just started looking at something and I said to myself out loud, oh my God, I love that. And then I just stopped and realized, okay, why do I love that? And I would stop, and for me, I always draw it. So when I started with the lifeguard stand, both because I was thinking of It's Perfect Here and they're the lifeguards. But also as an object, it's just perfect for me in the way that it becomes anthropomorphic. As far as, I'm glad you picked up on the horizon. I'm a huge fan of Mark Strand's book on Hopper, where he talked about the horizon as metaphorical and how the horizon is used throughout the history of painting. Particularly, he was talking about in Hopper. But for me, the ability to have the horizon is a way to exit the work. So the one paintings that really, the painting ends at the Santa Monica airport with a clear horizon line and the plane actually taking off. So the rest of the paintings I think were twofold. One, I kind of was thinking about that. Two, it made me understand Diebenkorn more, because in Diebenkorn, you also see his horizon is so far at the top, right? Because in Santa Monica, it's hilly there and you're coming down. So your perspective of the horizon, unless you're really on the beach, is not the typical one that we see.
Yeah.
But those paintings were really more, for me, looking for, you know, key places. You know, like I said, I lived there, so the bowling alley was particularly important. Borofsky's clown was particularly important as a locator, both of art, but also of that corner. But also when I was there on 4th Street and Rose, you know, it's a horrendous, really sad homeless population crisis. So I tried to actually do both.
It's interesting if you also think about the typewriter. So I was thinking again about, you know, the relationship, let's say, between, you know, the address of painting when it comes to things like landscape or portraiture, that's sort of the 90 degree address. And then, you know, obviously the sort of famous notion of Rauschenberg's work as moving to the flatbed picture plane with you know, a sort of collection of objects. But the typewriter is an object, is something in between those two. And it struck me that like the way that you were approaching the landscape in Santa Monica and the way that you're approaching landscape becomes the sort of, you know, embodiment. We're sort of hunched over our computer screens these days. We're sort of hunched over the computer screens on Zoom as well. You know, but there's this like not quite the surface of a table, but also not quite the fully looking up out into the world. And the typewriter, even though it's a sort of vintage piece of equipment, occupies, you know, a different kind of address to the world, of a way of registering it or a way of approaching it, even if it's sort of a one that comes up in the you know, confronts us in a different way. And so I'm sort of curious to develop this idea of like the way that you push the typewriter as both, you know, at one time, like sort of a window into these other worlds, at another time, this very material object that we're confronted with, at another time, it becomes a kind of Jasper Johns type of matrix that allows you to work through a bunch of different sort of types of format. So a little bit more to me about, you know, why it is that the typewriter, I mean, I know your relationship to writers is very important, but how does it the typewriter as a formal object, as an organizing object for painting, still hold this kind of attraction for you?
So I would say that I am really a still life painter and a portrait painter, but even my portraits are always located in the space of still life. And what I've realized over the last 20 years of the typewriter is that the typewriter for me is in a way to make portraits. I think a lot about Van Gogh's portrait of Dr. Cachat, and he wrote one of the letters. He painted Dr. Cachat because he felt that his face represented the times they were in, like the feelings of the times he was in, not because of who Dr. Cachat looked like. And so these typewriters allow me to do that. The space in them, generally similar to my landscape paintings in the plein air, is a still life space. You know, I think there are three kinds of painters: landscape, still life, portrait painters, in terms of the kind of space that they're in. When I was a young student, Nick Marsicano used to say there were three kinds of painters: crucifixion, Madonna, and deposition painters, I think, or annunciation painters. And, you know, that was almost 50 years ago. But so I think that in order to make that kind of compressed space allows me then to bust out a spot where maybe there's a tree or there is a way to use space to really enhance that and to give a different kind of feeling from one painting to the next. So I think if we look at Feel It, I think was the painting we were gonna go to next. This one. So I think this is a good example of what you're asking, because in one sense it's set up on a tabletop, on that checkered tabletop, which to me, I started looking at Cézanne as a young painter and the way that they would have that platform to have objects.
Right.
Or Chardin. Then you have, and this painting for me encompasses everything in the show and my and all of my work. So the typewriter could be this form that we understand as what it is in terms of scale. And then on the left, you have that kind of spray painted in, half painted figure bent over to it. So all of a sudden then the typewriter becomes this quite large, like public art scale object. And then just the way it's made, it's just dissolving and breaking apart and trying to come together. And this is, I've talked about this the other day, is I'm a huge fan of Jimi Hendrix in the way that he uses a Star Spangled Banner. And this goes to what you're asking, is the typewriter for me becomes this object that everyone knows and everyone has their own response to it. Some are like, oh, that's too old, I'm not interested in it. Some are, that's how I got all my information. Some are, you know, it's a social way to connect. But so we all have that, and then we can all start to look at the way it's pulled together or breaking apart differently. And then the last thing I'll say in this particular painting is, it goes back to oil paint, spray paint, acrylic paint, rubber cement, the way I started making paintings in high school to the way I am now, which is also like the Jimi Hendrix thing of like just using, thinking of myself as a painter. The other thing maybe we could talk about is, that I came across the typewriter, you know, my life, you know, I taught for many years and I don't start with a conceptual idea. You know, my work always comes out of my wanderings and my drawing and my bumping into someone or something. And so I bumped into the typewriter when I met Paul Auster. And it was a way for me then to just, to continue to build on that. And then to find ways to talk about other things. I'm a, you know, like I think about Rambeau's line of one must be absolutely modern in season and hell. And as a young painter, I always thought, okay, that means I have to use other materials. I have to be inventive at every moment. But now I realize, to me at least, what it means is to be a citizen. And to be modern is to be just aware of the moment I'm in. So the paintings have changed. You know, I made a painting in, I think, 2004 when we entered Iraq using the typewriter, thinking about Picasso's Weeping Women. Mm-hmm. So it's that vehicle.
I want to go back to this, the sort of techniques or the tactics that you said that you've used throughout your entire career, because it occurred to me that the show is really a kind of tour of all of those techniques and all of those tactics, everything from the heavy impasto to the airbrush, spray paint. You know, how, you know, in your mind, is there a, not necessarily a hierarchy, but is there a kind of ordering of or a significance to those tactics when you turn to one, what kinds of things you're trying to get out of the one tactic versus another tactic and where they're being deployed in the various different paintings? Because it changes, right? It's never like the keys are treated one way or the body of the typewriter is treated another way. In fact, there's almost like there's a sort of combination of various different tactics going on for the various different typewriters that you've made.
Yeah, I mean, I think I'll answer that. And I think maybe we could look at the slide that's called Seeking Signs. The other thing, just on a technical way that I like to paint is, you know that's gung-ho heart. So Seeking Signs is, it's further down the list, but I always wanted to figure out how to get drawing in, you know, this painting. I always wanted to try to figure out how to get drawing into my paintings. And, you know, as a kid, I mean, I was just blown away by Alice Neal. And so, like, if you look on the right-hand side with this flower bomb or the dog in the bottom or the left side where that totem is, that's all made with spray paint and rubber cement. And then the middle, this painting is really, I was thinking about what you're talking about, because the left side of the painting is black oil paint. The right side is washed acrylic from Nova Color, which I'll give them a plug. They make incredible acrylic paint out in LA. And my dog. So this painting is a lot of that. And then you can see there's like that right side where it breaks into the darkness, which is really supposed to be the typewriter being in my room with my dog and everything is fine. And then really trying to always maintain, it's very simple, but the handlebar, which you can turn, becomes an eye, is out in the world. You know, so those kinds of ways. And also the repetition of the form. When I first started teaching at Yale, I first started doing a grad course of portraits, and all the kids did was I would pair them up, and every week they would have to spend, it was like a 2-hour class, an hour in each other's studio making a portrait, 1 week, every week for a semester. And so after like 6 weeks, they got bored. And, you know, of trying to make it look like them, or caring that it really looked like them. And then at that point, because I still made them keep doing it, they became really inventive paintings. So they started figuring out, okay, what else do I do with this? And how else do I make this so I'm not embarrassed to show it to someone? I remember when I first had that class, another faculty member thought I should be fired because they thought it was embarrassing that at Yale grad school, they were teaching a portrait class. This was like 1996, right? And now I don't think they think that, but but that's the other reason why I stick to it. And I think that also, if you look at the typewriters, when you go back and look at the plein air paintings, you know, there's a natural inclination to the way I see form. I think all painters do that. So I've never had any interest in going out and painting landscape, except when I was at Skowhegan, because I didn't know what to do. And I thought, oh, Van Gogh went out into the fields and painted landscape. So I did that.
It's also interesting that, I mean, when you've gone out and done the plein air work, it's very much you looking out into the world and registering what you're seeing. And there's a one-way vector there. When I go see this show, each of these paintings is looking back at us, even in a very literal sense, that you've incorporated these eyes into the anthropomorphic treatment of the typewriters. So how is that working with you as the artist of these works? Do you feel as if, you know, you're now sort of under inspection from your own work? Are you expecting the viewer to feel like they're under inspection from these paintings?
Yeah, I mean, okay, this is going to sound weird, but like when I was in high school, I took classes at the Art Students League. And actually my teacher was Raphael and Moses and Isaac Sawyer. But there was a woman from Russia in the class who freaked me out. She was much older and I was like much younger than everyone else. And she said that she could see auras of people. Like she could see people walking down the street and their face would be dissolving because she knew they were going to die soon. So I would never look at her directly in the face. But she also told me that the way paintings maintain energy, what she said, there's a Corot in the Met, and you can always see Corot put faces in the clouds, and that had kept the energy in the painting so that there was this dialogue between the painting and the viewer. And, you know, and I, in a lot of ways, I feel that way, right? So the eyes are one thing, because I guess I also started really more and more thinking of these as particularly as portraits, but also it's just a way to engage. The other thing that you don't, you know, we just met, but I just draw all the time. So like whenever we're going anywhere, I usually have a sketchbook and I'm just drawing. And I have, you know, more drawings than I've thrown away still of just being out in the world. And so when I get into the studio, I'm really thinking about what does it mean to make a narrative painting? And like those plein air paintings I put into a narrative by making an animation. If they weren't an animation, they would just be an object. And my drawings often are narrative in the sense of things happening, people doing an action. But the paintings, I'm not interested in that kind of narrative in my painting. Or if the narrative is there, it's a much more pushed into the back.
So, I mean, that's interesting, because if you said that what it means to be modern, if you're going to respond to Rimbaud's sort of, you must be modern, and mm-hmm. what you feel the response to that is a citizen, is to be a citizen. Part of that in the drawing is about witnessing, but then the paintings do something else. They have to synthesize something beyond the witnessing that's happening in the drawing. So how in your mind are the paintings a sort of manifestation of that citizenship?
So like the painting that's the screenshot behind you, I think is a great example. To me, it's really just about climate change. And, you know, you are actually sitting under the horizon in the future, right? And above your head is kind of the present, where we're walking around with our head above water thinking everything is perfect here. But really down below is happening now, or where we're going. And, you know, in the second horizon line, which is inside the mouth of the typewriter, if you really look at it, for me on the right side there are fires. There were fires this summer, last summer when I was out in California. You know, there are the fires, there's actually the drought in front of it, there's the water. So these are like literal things. And then the keys also were from, you know, we drove back and forth cross country, and it's so scary and it's so sad. So much of this country has been decimated by the opioid crisis. Like once you get off I-5 and you start driving to the north, it's just heartbreaking. So those things are all in there for me. And that's why I like to think when I think about El Greco, he had his own kind of religiousness. He had his own spirituality. I don't know how much he personally believed, but he used it as a way to speak about different things. And I think like the burial of Count d'Orthez is the perfect example of that, because it has three spaces, the burial ground, the ground we're in. He also made it to a scale, which this is a similar scale, where you could stand in front of the typewriter and it's actually as big as you are. Mm-hmm. And then in like the El Greco, it above you moved up into no gravity. So, you know, that's my biggest concern in most of the paintings is climate change.
But that's just a kind of, you know, with El Greco and particularly, let's say allegorical component, right? And we're working within a kind of framework of spiritual illumination, a kind of even textual illumination. Here, you know, I think one of the sort of dominant modes that we're seeing today in contemporary art, and a lot of work that artists are doing, is a kind of allegorical social realism, whether that has to do with questions of identity, whether it has to do with questions of climate, whether it has to do with questions of politics. And so I'm curious about, you know, what is the mode is an interesting one for your paintings, because there's a little bit of the kind of symbolist activity. There's a little bit of the, you know, it's not quite allegorical, but I'm trying to sort of figure out what kind of model of meaning we can take to sort of understand some things we have to take sort of simply as they are. The keys turn into pills and they're falling onto the ground here. You know, we have to take certain things at face value, but at the same time, we're dealing with a more highly charged, you know, surface of significance. And so, you know, why take certain things to be about climate change and another things just to be about, you know, the practice of a certain type of pictorial activity, right? A certain kind of representational strategy.
So
it feels to me difficult to say like, it's just about climate change.
Well, it's not just about climate change, but to me, that is something that helps me make some decisions when I'm making the work. you know, in basic, I just like to make things, and I'm constantly making. And I really find the meaning ways to make decisions as I'm making the work. And that is by, you know, I think of that Roth painting poem, The Waking, where I learn by going where I need to go. So the paintings lead me where I need to go. like I said, that's how I find my interest in the paintings. One thing leads me to another. It's how I met John Searle. My wife was writing an article on self-taught painters, and it led me into a whole world which I explored for like 10 years through work. I don't claim to be able to even myself know what all the paintings are about. You know, I don't. I make them, I look at them and I learn from them, and then it makes me hopefully want to make another one. But I think that, and as a citizen, or what you asked, how they locate themselves, so much of the work being made today is so explicitly narrative based or in a lot of ways, I would almost say didactic in wanting the meaning to, you know, to be like, okay, this is what this is about. And I don't, you know, my poems, I like my paintings to be more like poetry in the sense that they can lead you somewhere, but they may lead the same. If 10 people are looking at it, they're all going to go in 10 different directions. And so the first thing that I think is important is I want people to want to look at them. You know, I think it's really important how they're made, the way they're made, this, you know, that they have this energy that people want to look at them and then can spend enough time with you know, maybe today and maybe for the next week, this painting feels about something else. But then as things in the world change, hopefully the painting changes with it. And that's the way I think we look at old work, at old writings. I'll just say that one, you know, I taught for 25 years, and I think the best crit ever, we were talking about Ahmed al-Sudani's paintings. I think I mentioned this to you. Mm-hmm. And he had a painting of someone being, you know, his head, you know, brains being blown off, and he was falling off a cliff and there were trees. And this one faculty member was like, I don't understand this, Ahmed. This doesn't make sense. What is this saying? Right? This guy is in the sky, but this is happening. And Mel Bachner just looked at him and said, well, you know, so-and-so, do you read poetry? And, and the guy goes, yeah, of course. And he goes, do you always understand it? And he goes, no. And Mel just pointed to the painting and said, poetry. And, you know, that's hopefully what I aspire to, is that people can look at this and, you know, and feel one thing, but hopefully they feel something, right? To me, that's also the most important thing in the world now, is that we can actually connect and feel something and be connected like that.
So to switch gears a moment then, I'm sort of curious to take this to the teaching of painting to aspiring painters and in MFA programs or in other types of programs. I think most artists would agree, you know, that they want to make work that's going to make people feel something, but that's, you know, if that is a kind of universal in terms of wanting to register some kind of affective response, right? Wanting it to connect and wanting it to have a place that it sort of takes up in the mind and the being of a potential audience member or someone who's seen this thing. Mm-hmm. How, you know, obviously every painter has to kind of figure out their own path to being able to do that. But how do you impart that to a student in a way that sort of means getting it beyond the narrative or the didactic or trying to make something that means something, and move another painter off of their, you know, seat of conviction that they know what they are already doing? Or maybe the artists who have come to you as students, you know, aren't that convinced. And so maybe the point is you have to develop that conviction for them. But, you know, how have you as a teacher of painting try to move students either on or off their seat of conviction?
So, you know, I was talking recently to an old student of mine, Chie Fuki, and about this, and I just said, because she said, you know, I was such an important teacher for her. And I said, well, I don't think I was ever a teacher, but I think I was a pretty good pointer, right? Actually, I said somebody else, to Brooke, but that I could notice things and just point to, and it could be something as simple as like, put a desk in your studio, right? Like get, you know, organize the space so that you can work. But the most important thing I think was that I tried to teach the students was to not to run away from being embarrassed, but to run towards it. Because I think that that's where their work was themselves. And then however good or bad it's gonna be, at least it was theirs. Because when they weren't really embarrassed, it already looked like somebody else's work. So they felt very comfortable and everyone else felt comfortable and they could all talk about it. So, you know, I did that. And then the other thing, it took me a long time to learn this, probably after I stopped teaching, which was a couple of years ago, was I think being a teacher is really telling stories, at least in the arts, right? In painting, in an art school. And, you know, I realized so much of my teaching was telling stories of my teachers or my experiences, things that happened to me. And at a certain point I thought, okay, it's time for me. And a lot of my old students are now teaching and running departments. It's like, I can become part of their story. I don't need to still be the story, right? And it's time for them to have their stories to pass on. Because I think it's by hearing those stories, it's not that you should emanate those stories, but you should realize, shit, those people were doing weird things, or they were doing things that, you know, oh, you can do that. And I think what people, you know, I started noticing this and it's gotten more and more, is that people are less and less open to experience, right?
What do you mean by that? Less and less open to experience?
Well, they think there has to be one way to go, right? Whether that's to make money, to have a gallery, to make a certain kind of work, and not to just you know, start as something and be something else. You know, I remember, and this is, when I taught the undergraduates at Yale, it was really easy to explain because I would give them an assignment, which was a Cooper Union home test assignment, was do a self-portrait in two places at once, which on the surface is easy. You can make a selfie, you're drawing, and you could be standing on a map of two states, right? But in art school, kids would just think, oh, okay, I can do whatever I want. But in Yale, because they had spent their whole life taking SATs and knowing the right, there was one answer, like 80% of them would email me and say, Professor Messer, what do you exactly mean by that, right? Because they thought there was one answer. And I was like, no, there's not one answer. You just have to convince me that your answer is interesting, right? And I'm not saying, and I don't want that to be misunderstood, is like, we're in the world of alternative facts now, right? And alternative truths, because it's the opposite of that. Like I'm not, you know, and hopefully the paintings talk about that. But just as being a teacher, it was that, okay, it was okay just to paint somebody's portrait. It's okay to be dumb, right? That you don't have to have this very current moment, you know, idea of what it means to be able to construct a work.
If you had, I know your teaching days are a little bit dumb, but if you had a wealthy benefactor came to you and said they wanted to start a new school of painting and you had carte blanche to run it the way that you wanted to, and so for the sake of this question, you are going to say yes to that because this seems like a great opportunity. What would be the first things that you would do? What are the first decisions that you would make about how to set this up that would be different from what you've experienced so far?
Well, I would set it up exactly the way I ran the Norfolk Summer School for 20 years, okay? And I would love that opportunity if someone came to me and said that, because I think that I would put other people in charge. But, you know, I'll tell, and when I say, you know, when I ran the Norfolk Summer School, when I left, and this is like, I'll tell the whole story. When I left, I got, and they were making me professor emeritus at Yale. I got called into the office because faculty at Brown had sent a letter, an anonymous letter. Of course, Yale shouldn't have told me it was from Brown, but saying that they said that I allowed for a promiscuous atmosphere at Norfolk. And I said to the Title IX, the person in charge of Title IX, I said, absolutely. I said, and I'm proud of that. I said, but they're 21-year-old kids. You know, I was very strict that that promiscuous atmosphere did not move over to the faculty or the TAs, but amongst the students, yes, because this was a place to actually, to learn whether they wanted to be an artist or not, to learn how much time they want to spend being an artist. And also to, they're out in the woods to, you know, to see what it means, what kind of materials do you want? You know, there you could be in your studio, you could be out in the world, you could be doing anything you want. So I would start a school that was promiscuous. You know, I would start a school that was promiscuous in the ideas of making. I'm not talking about sexuality now. Mm-hmm. I'm not talking about taking drugs, but I'm talking about just being promiscuous and not thinking, oh, I'm a figurative painter that paints narrative and I have to continue to do that, right? If you wanted to sit down and just paint a cup of tea like Chardin did 300 years ago with steam coming out of it, you could do that and you could probably find some real meaning in that. You know, maybe if you wanted to just work about color, you could do that. At the same time, I would have people there that were engaged with the other ideas that we're talking about, like how do you make color in a painting reflect to the issues of color that in the world now? So it would allow for all of that, but it wouldn't allow for the tamping down of conversation.
Who are the most promiscuous writers that you would have your students read?
Well, of course, I always go back to my friend Denis Johnson. But I'm trying to think who's, and now I'm just drawing blank because, you know, this is the 500th episode and I'm 500. who's the guy who wrote like the 1,000-page books? And he travels all over the world and he like sits himself up into it, into all kinds of situations.
Bowman, William Bowman?
Yeah, yeah.
Here from here in Southern California, like, yeah.
Yeah.
Sure. Okay. But why?
Because he puts himself into the world and just writes about it. right? And he's not afraid to put himself into any situation. The other, which is a very different in terms of promiscuous or open, I would say is Sharon Olds. You know, and I'll, you know, I am confined to my own experience. So I've been close to Sharon lately and working with her, but I find her poetry so open to her life experience and also just into the moment, right? Anything that happens to her that she comes across in the news or walking down the street, she immediately writes a poem about it. So I think those and there's something on a YouTube called Tripolar TV, which is something else that I find really.
Never heard of that. What is Tripolar TV?
It's this little, it's a web series about just trying to insult everyone. You know, equally.
Do you think, should artists move their studios more, move their practice when you say sort of being out in the world? Should artists get away from having these, you know, the aspiring to a kind of operational studio in one place, one city with one kind of output?
You know, part of my school would be not to tell anyone anything they have to do. But personally, I think it's a great idea. Because personally, what I think it means is you actually have, the world is, as we know, one place, but a very big place and many experiences. And I think that to not allow yourself that opportunity to be put into the other parts of the world and other experiences is holding one back. In my own way of making things, in my own way of wanting to be in the world. For other people, it may not have any interest, but personally, I think there's such a benefit from that, from like what happened for me going to California again, and just really, you know, putting in the light and the color. That's not any kind of great conceptual construct, but it does make me think, okay, yeah, so, but it is about being in the world, right? About being out of the studio in the world. And then the paintings in the show were made in the studio. So hopefully there's a way to carry that into the studio so you don't have to like be making your paintings outside in different parts of the world all the time. But what I think it does mean is to be open to experiences. And I'll go back, my friend Denis once said to me, Denis Johnson over the phone, he said, oh yeah, anything is possible and it could be extraordinary. It could also turn to shit, but it could be extraordinary. And I just think that, so for that, I think it's really good. Like now I just want to go to other parts of the world and set up for like 2 months and just start drawing and then just see what happens.
I was going to ask, is 2 months enough? How long did it take in California or to the point where you felt like it actually registered a shift in your practice or interest in what it is that you wanted to produce?
Well, California may be a misnomer because I lived there before, so I knew the place.
The ground was seeded, but you know,
but I've done it before.
Enough. Yeah,
it was enough for me, and it also depends on the way someone works. Right. So, like, you know, I'm of the school of I made these paintings in 2.5 months and 66 years, right? You know, from kind of taking that Picasso line. You know, I used to go to this artist colony, Moonhole in Beckley in the West Indies. And that was the only other place where I did this, where I used to go out with Sally Mann. Sally was also at the artist colony at the same time. And she would be taking photographs and I was just making paintings of, like she was taking photographs of the graveyard. I made paintings of the graveyard. I made paintings of the grave digger. You know, and I built this body of work, which I showed in the 90s at David Beitzel, that was really of that place. So for me, 2 months, 3 months is enough.
Yeah.
Because I'm just always out there drawing and in it. For someone else, they may need 2 years.
But yeah, I mean, I guess I was thinking more about like the, you know, beyond the content, but more of how the place seeps into or begins to register in the work in a way that may be more formal or less intended. I'm thinking, you know, there's great Sean Scully moving from London to New York, and you see changes in colors and structure of the abstractions, and you know, and since it's not about content, it's more about the sort of registration of the atmospherics in a way, which I've always found compelling. So, you know, there's a tendency today, artists, you know, you go to a residency, you go to an artist colony, you've got a couple weeks here, a couple months there, content changes. I'm sort of curious to think about, you know, how long does it take for the place to kind of register in these more unconscious moments and unconscious decisions, and then to be able to look at them, say, you know, 6 months later, and be able to register like, hey, that was, you know, that was really a function of the place that I was in at that point versus what I was seeing, or the sort of direct onboarding of the experience.
So one thing, I can't speak to Sean Scully because I'm not in that, but I think of Malcolm Morley, who would go places, you know, and actually would make sketches in places and then come back and build work that I found really interesting. But I think the way you even, you know, ask that question, which is go from one residency to another, I think by going to a residency, you're separating yourself from the experience in a lot of ways. I can't speak to Kehinde's Black, I think it's called Black Rock, because I don't know it, unless people have been there. But I think that might be, I'm hoping that might be an exception, and like, although it looks so fancy, it might not be. But what I'm saying is going to a place, but put yourself in that world, right? Not put yourself into a cloistered world of other artists where you're like all talking about the same people and the same connections you knew back from where you all came from, or maybe how you interacted, but just putting yourself into the world where you are. And then everyone's different, you know? I think that, you know, Hunter Thompson, you know, Denis Johnson, people like that, that used to go out and be those kind of journalists, right? I remember Denis came back and when he wrote Tree of Smoke, which he won the National Book Award, Denis had only spent like 2 weeks in Vietnam in his whole life. He'd been through that part of the world growing up there, but he went there. When he came back, he said, I just wanted to know what it smelled like.
Right.
Right. And so I think for everyone, it's different, but I think if you put yourself off the track, like you don't walk the same road where everybody else who goes there walks, you just go off the other way. Yeah. Things will happen and you'll find things that you can do something with.
I think that makes sense. I want to make sure that we've got any questions from our audience able to be entered here. I would just add sort of one more question to you, Sam, as we begin to look to the audience members for anything they might want to ask too. Of you know, in your opinion, what kind of support do new generations of artists need, or how do we get them, you know, to get out into the world, rather than maybe accepting that, you know, part of getting out there right now is like engaging in kind of, you know, online communities, present community excluded. But I think that there's a sense that, you know, there's a world sort of in the computer screen that connects you with communities that you might not ever get access to through various different social media platforms or other ways of getting engaged. And that seems like it seems, I don't want to say it seems like a poor substitute for getting out in the world, but it's not quite the same thing, even though it might have a real impact on the way it is that artists could work. You know, how do we, you know, what are some of your thoughts, you know, now that you don't have to do this officially, what's some of the advice that you would want to give that you might not have given if you were in the institutional frame?
Okay, so Eleanor, can you pull up the painting Comrade? While I answer this. So I think that, you know, the internet is an incredible way to actually meet people. You know, I found that poem by Brother Richard about the lockdown online, someone forwarded to me that was on the BBC. And then I started making animation, and then I reached out to him, and actually we talked, and we actually Zoomed in the middle of the night. So I think it is a way to actually meet people. I don't think, what I've learned is you don't have to actually meet someone. It's a benefit to be able to actually meet them together. But I think that, but to dig deeper, so like not just to read what someone says, but to actually then to reach out to them. And there's so many ways with WhatsApp, with Zoom, with FaceTime, to actually to talk to people and to see them in their space. And so like this painting, Comrade, I made actually for the Brooklyn Rail for their benefit, right? To try to actually have an endowment. And you know, this was made at the same time as all the other paintings in California, but I was thinking of Brooklyn, so it's a little darker. But I was also thinking of Fong, who always, you know, responds to everything with Comrade. So I think that and the Brooklyn Rail is a great example of, you know, you can read things, but then you can reach out to people that write them, or you can look, you can follow up on them and try to meet them. I met William Eggleston, you know, by writing to him saying, oh, can I do your portrait? And he was like, I guess so. And I went to Memphis and painted his portrait. And then I learned I'm not interested in Wiggle and him as a person, but I was I made a painting that I found interesting. The other person who did an incredible thing when I first came to New York, and I wish someone did this again, was PS1 was originally a space for artist studios. And the other night, Ralph Hansen from Sweden called me, who had a studio there. I haven't spoken to him since the 80s. And I remember Alana Heiss ran it, and it was just this wild place where for like $60 a month, we had a classroom. You know, and now I kind of weep. I go there and my old studio classroom, they was showing the paraphernalia of all the exhibits that PS1 MoMA now do, right? So it's no longer a space to make, it's a space to exhibit. So I think that people, younger people, I think need to get out of their box in any way they can, whether that's through the internet, through writing a letter, through to meet someone else, and then maybe you'll go there, maybe you'll meet someone there, but it becomes a collaboration. And once you do that, I think it's hard for you not to have that in your own work, right? To have as many voices as you can and many experiences. So, yeah.
Yeah, I mean, it's interesting advice, because I think that, one of the, and I don't know if you've seen this as well, I'm curious to, as your thoughts about how this kind of evolved over the time at Yale, but there's almost, among the other crises, there's a kind of crisis of confidence that I see in generations that are coming up through these institutions that are a lot about this feeling of like, oh, I can't reach out to that person, right? Like I haven't either proved myself, or I don't have a credential, or I haven't gone through whatever gauntlet is required of me before I can make contact. But it would seem like in this environment in particular, that's exactly what a young artist or even a mid-career artist would need to continue to cultivate as a way of working in order to be open to those new types of experiences. In your time, did you see have you seen a similar kind of transformation in that that ability to be confident, that ability to have the strength of one's own convictions?
For myself or for others?
Both, for yourself.
For myself, yeah, but I think I always kind of had that in terms of if I was, I found that through drawing, I could meet anyone, because I would draw them and they would either become interested or talk to me, or I could ask someone if I could draw them. And drawing, unlike photography, people are open to, because they don't expect it to be anything.
Right. Right. It's not evidentiary. But, you're not going to, it's not going to show up and get them in trouble.
Yeah. But it's a way to then start a conversation. And I think over the years, I've become much more confident in that ability. And that's what I used to tell my students is draw more. And by drawing, you can meet anybody. And I've met really extraordinary people, both, to the lowest low to the highest high, just through drawing. Or reaching out and saying, hey, would you mind if I just came and sat in the room and drew you? You don't have to talk to me. And I guess that started when I was at Cooper. I realized that because Stevie Wonder had the entire second floor of the Fifth Avenue Hotel. And I became friends with the band. And I said, would it be okay if I drew? And they said, yeah, just don't, you're not allowed to talk to Stevie. And I would sit on the piano while they were practicing and I was drawing them, and it showed me that as long as I was doing something, with other people that were also doing things, people are into that, And so I think it's a way to move through the world. I don't think that answers your question, because I kind of drifted, but.
No, I love that, because, it does, if anything, it's like, it's a tactic that one could use just to try. It's like, all right, rather than pulling out your phone and pretending like you're, in an important text conversation with somebody when you're in a new place, bring a sketchbook and sit down and start drawing what's going on, and people, inherently less threatening, more interesting and curious. And so, it's a way of getting engaged that maybe more of us should take on board.
And just to prove, I don't know, can you see me? Because my screen's all I see is you.
Yeah, I can see you.
Can you see that?
Yeah.
So that's you. So I'm just saying, I do what I say.
I like it. I want to, do we have any questions, Eleanor, in the chat that we've?
We do. Yeah, we can move on to the audience Q&A. Thank you so much, Sam and Jonathan. That was really an amazing conversation. That was, super, super amazing to hear and witness. Our first question will be from Lynn Crawford. So Lynn, you should be able to unmute now and ask your question.
Oh. Lynn's still on mute.
Lynn, I think you're still muted.
Sorry, this was remarkable. And Sam, I really appreciated what you said about working in quote unquote unremarkable places. And it just makes me think of all the amazing work that's been lost, you know, maybe a poem in an apron packet or something that someone sketched, you know, when they were out in the field or maybe on the break in a factory or something. And I just loved what you said about humans just working within their dailiness. And I was curious to hear you talk a little more about that.
Well, I was always the kid at school who the teachers reprimanded because they didn't think I was paying attention because I was But that's the way I actually pay attention, right? And so I just think, you know, I've just learned from going around the world, and also particularly when my wife Eleanor Gaver wrote that article on self-taught artists in the 80s, and we met people, just the necessity to make. And that necessity to make is everywhere.
Yeah.
You know, particularly, like I was in Indonesia, people there just making, you know, everyone's an artist, right? Everyone is making things. And so I just think, you know, when there's a sculpture in my current show and the guy who polished it was an artist, you know, the way that he approached the polishing and the way that he really thought about the decisions. So I think people are always making things. And I think they're always, you know, that's the nature of humanity, right? Is the earliest things. People have been making things forever, abstractly, figuratively, but they've been making. And the importance of it is usually dictated by someone else and other people and how much attention it gets. And that goes in and out, right? In the early 1900s, nobody looked at El Greco. Now it's hard to imagine that people had put El Greco in the basement, right? It took Picasso and maybe some others who found them and were interested to get them out of the basement. So I think the most important thing is if you have the urge to make, you just make, you know, and you find any ways to make it and you use any material as you can, right? And I was, you know, brought up in the school, oh, everything had to last for 500 years. Clearly that doesn't matter anymore because clearly we may not make it another 50 years. So I think it's really necessary just to do it. As Nancy Reagan said, right? Just do it. She said that to Frank Sinatra.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you, Lynn, for your question. We will now turn the mic over to Agnes. Agnes GR. Do you want to turn your camera on if you feel comfortable for a moment, Agnes?
I think we have the mic on.
We have the mic on.
Okay. Hi. I'm fiddling with the camera, but maybe it won't work. I'm in my studio and not the greatest connection. But my question was about the idea of promiscuity. I really love the description that Sam provided about being promiscuous, being brave enough to be promiscuous in your work, meaning just, I guess how I understand it, experimenting, being ready to experiment and trying different different directions. That just feels very natural to the way we live and see the world, and just things that happen to us. Why would we stay stagnant? However, there is some danger of not being, you know, or at least being perceived as not being faithful to your style or the themes in your work for an artist. And I was wondering how Sam would see that and what would be his view on that. Thank you so much. I really love the conversation.
Well, I would say being faithful to your style is the same way that rich people like to think that artists like to be poor, right? And it's just a myth. And I think, you know, I'm a huge fan, a great fan of Stanley Whitney's work. And you know, his ability to maintain the grid as a form to work for years is something that, you know, that I relish, and I wish people would give me the same kind of pass, right, in my own work. But I also do many other things. So I think that one should not worry about it having to have a style, right? That is for other people to want to be able to understand you in. I think if you do and you necessitate what you need to do, eventually people will come around to it or they don't. But at least when you did, you made what you needed to make. So I think that's a lot more important.
Mm-hmm. Yeah,
Jonathan, you want to add?
I was going to say, so two things. I love that you mentioned Whitney, because the painting formerly Feral, unmistakable homage to Stanley Whitney's work in the background there, which I thought was fantastic. I was going to ask you that, but we were running out of time, so I'm just going to take that as an affirmative.
Yeah, it is, and it wasn't a mockery of Stanley. It was it was the way that I used to use, and like, I'll just pull it off the wall here. Like, this was, I don't know if you can see it, but this is a painting I did at Cooper Union in like 1974. I don't know if you can see it.
Lower it down a little bit. Yeah, there you go. Yeah.
But I used the composition from Tintoretto and from other painters. And, you know, through my whole life, I would do that. So I figured, okay, I like Stanley's. I just seen his show. I loved it. And it was in my head. So I just used it.
Yeah. No, but I also like that Agnes also brought up this idea of being faithful, right? And not necessarily faithful to his style, but I think that there's a real push and pull that's worth exploring between the notion of promiscuity and the notion of fidelity. And you don't have to have fidelity to a style, but there's a kind of a fidelity to some core concerns or interests. Sam, with you, I think that there's something about this idea of witnessing and making and citizenship, which would be, you know, fidelity to a set of, again, not principles, but to like a center of gravity that constantly sort of pulls you around. That doesn't mean that the work has to look a certain way or has to register a certain way, but that organizes one's way of making or way of being in the world, and that the work becomes a registration of that, and that you know, allows the kind of promiscuity to happen as well, right? I mean, I think that, you know, all fidelity or all promiscuity probably gets you, you know, just a kind of one-sided practice that ultimately kind of burns out either way, and so there's got to be that productive tension between those two things.
Yeah, I love it the way that you talk about it, because that's a better, clearer way to understand what I say about Jimi Hendrix.
Yeah.
You know, or I think of Thelonious Monk, like playing the wrong notes right. Like, right. I think it's really important to know your craft.
Right.
And then to be able to decide when you want to use it.
Right.
You know, and yeah, so I'm glad we came back to that, because I think promiscuity is really another word for me for inventiveness.
Right. Right. And but you can't, you know, let's leave it there. Yeah. Eleanor, do we have another question, or should we?
We do. We have a couple more. Our next question will be from Cal, who is one of our team members here at The Rail. Cal, I think you should be able to turn on your mic if you're here.
Great. Thank you, Eleanor. And thank you, Sam. Thank you, Jonathan. This has been a terrific conversation. As you may know, we at The Rail, we're working on a large curatorial project of showing taught and self-taught artists together. So we all kind of have self-taught art percolating in our brains right now. And so Sam, I know you're trained and you've worked in academic spaces, but what have you gleaned or taken from taught or from self-taught or outsider artists? Do you have favorite self-taught artists?
Well, I think that one has to be really careful. You know, to me, self-taught is Van Gogh was self-taught, right? So I think Kiki Smith once said to me, the difference between visionary and self-taught artist is a visionary artist's work never gets better, or a self-taught artist, you know, I think she said visionary, it never gets better. It might be fantastic, it might be bad, but it never changes. And so I think that there is nothing, you know, self-taught is like John Searle, who I made portraits of, was in a sense self-taught, but his house was filled with books. And he once said to me, I practice at being naive because I know that's what people like. I think that the problem with education or schools is that you become part of that history of that particular school. And as Charles Garabedian said once when he got out of school like in the 30s, he said, when you're in school, they tell you, you know, they beat out the bad stuff in your work. And he said, when I get out of school, I realized that bad stuff was also part of me. So I spent the next couple of years trying to get it back into me. So I think that being self-taught or not self-taught doesn't matter. I think how engaged someone is in trying to learn is what's important. And you don't have to go to school to become an interesting artist, right? You just have to be open to learning. Jonathan?
Yeah, I love that. I also, I always found there's an interesting in the art space, a contrast when we talk about someone as a real autodidact versus someone being a self-taught artist. And the one saying that someone is a real autodidact somehow has like a prestige to it. Like this is someone who, you know, regardless of whether they've got academic credentials, is, you know, someone who went and, you know, became, you know, fluent in some other discipline all by themselves, or has this kind of roving curiosity. But if you're a self-taught artist, somehow it speaks of this kind of struggle against or outside of the system. So I love Sam's description of that in terms of, you know, just having a driving curiosity. And I also tell a lot of my students, and especially when we do a lot of writing courses for students with writing and editing, is that no one can, you know, no one's again going to teach you how to be a writer, right? Like you have to want to do this. You have to learn how to do it yourself. You can just have people, I think, Sam, like you said, pointing you in the right directions and pointing out the things that might help or might be detracting from your own process of teaching yourself a craft.
Great. Thank you both so much.
Thank you, Cal, for that question. Our next question will be from CJ Jones. CJ, you should be able to unmute now.
Hello.
Hi.
Hi, Sam. Great to see your presentation and interview. I just wanted to ask if you've ever used a typewriter as a drawing instrument to type draw an image.
Oh, I tried that once many years ago. I made an elephant out of X's, but no.
Yeah, it requires a whole new way of learning to draw, I found. I just wanted to say I love your work. And is there any like sort of a book, any book in the future of your artwork that... all these typewriter paintings and everything?
The typewriter paintings, I have no idea. If someone wants to make one, sure. I'm trying to make a book of my project I did called Denis the Pirate, if anyone out there wants to make a book, but no.
Both great ideas.
Yeah, thank you so much. I've got other one from the library. I keep checking it out over and over.
You can buy them on eBay for like $20 sometimes.
Yeah, I hope so, yeah. Thank you.
I was just going to add, CJ, about the drawing, the typewriter is drawing. You should check out the Rails recent conversation on Carl Andre. And there was a brief moment there, the conversation about Andre's poetry and the use of the typewriter. And there's an interesting back and forth there about how the typewriter is really the same type of typewriter that Sam paints itself became a matrix, has a grid embedded into the way that the typewriter types in order and became the kind of medium that Andre was using when he was doing his poetry work. So regardless whether it was handwritten or typed, the typewriter became a kind of, I want to say medium, but that's not the exact right word, but became the thing that helped dictate how those concrete images were being put onto the page. So check out that rail conversation. I can't remember which one it was, but it might have been just 3 or 4 ago.
All right. Yeah. Thank you.
Thank you. And our final question will be from GE Schwartz, one of our most loyal fans. We're so excited to have a question. So glad you could come back, GE. So I'm happy to pass the mic over to you.
Thank you so much. Happy 500. It's been great. I mean, what a credit ride over the last 2 years. Thank you to the rail, and thank you, Eleanor, Nick, and of course, Fong and Cal and everybody there. I'm thinking a lot about the interplay and the intersections of drawing, painting, and text. And I'm wondering if you're interested in kind of connecting a lot of those forms in maybe the same kind of similar way or off way that maybe William Blake was involved in.
You're asking me?
Yes, sir. Yes. Yes, sir.
Well, Blake might be a way in terms of actually an inspiration. I mean, the earliest things I read was poetry, probably because of my attention span. I couldn't really read novels as a kid, but I just find like certain phrasings would actually make me want to make something. So I think, you know, my work isn't in that box of that world of people that are really using, say, text as, like, say, Mel Bochner's using text as a structure, or Dana Frankfurt, who actually was an old student of mine, who was one of the earliest people that I know who used text and still uses it in a really an amazing way. I remember she made paintings that were just, when she was in grad school, she couldn't locate herself, so she made a painting of the number of her studio and then her name. And I remember the faculty were like, you can't do this, right? And then, of course, she could do it, and she's still doing it in a very inventive way. So I use text, and I think the text that pops up in my work, like there's Don't Forget Me, is something that just like came across me during last summer during the pandemic, right? It was just something that, and it just has to be in the work. So that, you know, that's how it's not more formal for me than that, and it's not using it like the way Jonathan was talking about with that other artist, Andre, as a tool. You know, I use it like if you had a painting and there was someone in the background walking through.
Well, thank you. These works certainly speak for all of us too. So I'm so glad you made them. Thank you.
Thank you. Thanks for listening.
Excellent. Thank you so much for that final question, GE. We have a tradition here at the Rail of ending our community events with a poetry reading. Today, I'm thrilled to welcome our poet laureate of the day, Hannah Lamb Vines, to the stage. Poet, novelist, and critic Hannah Lamb Vines lives and works in Berkeley, California. She received an MFA in creative writing from California College of the Arts and uses humor, body horror, and anthropomorphized canines and urban wildlife to explore romantic obsession and other facets of life in late capitalism. She writes reviews for FF2 Media and is an interview editor at Full Stop. Her work in progress, Wolf Baby, is a novel about a woman who inexplicably births a sheepdog. And I cannot wait to hear your readings, Hannah. So I'm happy to pass the mic over to you.
Thank you so much, Eleanor. And thank you, Nick, Anya, Elizabeth, for organizing this and inviting me to read. And thanks, Sam and Jonathan. It was so cool to hear you talk about your work and your influences and your process. The first poem I'm going to read is Please Retain Receipt in Case of Return. And you can read this one in the most recent issue of the Bennington Review. Soft animal wakes hot, clawing at comfort, choking on open windows. It knows only what it means to be itself, empty object, like the fur-covered cup under glass. Oh, to be filled or filling, because the world is full, regret expands inside soft animal. Because the world is full, soft animal remains empty under glass. Subtraction is a relatively new invention. To say minus is to add a mark. Previously, energy remained at a stasis. Now, with certain strokes, what was there can be deleted. Soft animal blinks, depleted. Where does energy go anyway? Cupped with wasted moments, sleepless nights, soft animal sneezes. What was inside, outside. Light refracts through the droplets on the screen. Oh, to be outside itself or in its other. Soft animal can only imagine so much. Not stabbing, not wet skin embracing adrenaline, not that soft animal wants to be anything other than itself, empty object. But oh, to know what it is to be glass. This one is called Throat Chakra. When I say I miss my hair, I might mean I want to be a whole person. I have vicinities in my belly, religions untouched for 12 years. Grandmother's whisper in church pews, passing gum in the collection plate, if it all comes down to cousins. Death smells your fear, comes closer. I wish I had kissed you in the mouth instead of giggling past midnight. But you smell death where it hovers, just ahead. So your mother holds you. I can hear your morbid crying. My therapist says I'm sick too, but I don't suffer as loudly. I wear my compulsion like a blanket with holes, regretting what I consumed or didn't. If it all comes down to childhood, there is an infinity of mirrors. There are at least two ways to be sad, a baby, or a dying dog. When I say I want to be a whole person, I might mean I want my mother's attention. Someone to stroke my hair, feed me for what I hunger. A dying dog alone under the porch has no mother, wants no mother's attention. The porch in my belly turns to loam, ruled by dying dogs or mirrors. Their daughters howl, a hollow wind. Their cousins quiet. If it all comes down to attention, an oral fixation might be a survival tactic. My therapist suggests I listen to myself, but the weather is very loud. Though I say I want to be heard, I think I mean I want to be touched. Sustenance, sweat-salted fingers, before my belly caves in. This one is called Death Do Us Laugh, and it's based after the Denis Johnson poem, Heat. Shadow Wolf favors the seventh sin. You can tell by the curling fur on his chest. Under his moon yellow eyes, will you pledge 7-year promises with empty bottles of gin? I don't want to be your everything. I just want to be the best. Anything less is a boil deep beneath the center of my back, an edge sharp enough to carve the moon from its altar. Should you find yourself at year 3, ready to falter. Oh, tomorrow you are an infinitesimal fraction of a promise made to the moon on a night that danced with milky maenads in the hot Whole Foods parking lot on Telegraph Avenue. Will you tuck me into the silk spinning afternoon? Will you lock me in my promise with 7-year ironclads? I think I hear a howling on that mountain, deja vu. And the last one you can read on Hobart After Dark. It's called regarding my crush on John Cusack as Lloyd Dobler in the 1989 romantic comedy Say Anything. Where is my kickboxing man? In a loose and slouchy brown cotton blend with spacious hemmed sleeves, ideal for layering and available from primejackets.com for $139. Where is my romantic gesture, outmatching a gifted pen? A decade ago, I asked certain men to teach me to drive stick in the church parking lot on the south edge of town, down at the end of Quaker Avenue, the road I used to drive in my 91 Nissan Sentra, which was an automatic, all the way out to the tiny town where I cut my teeth and where I'd count shooting stars on monkey bars, which sounds romantic, but none of my wishes came true, and the cold metal left bruises on my butt. None of the men who tried to teach me how to drive were Lloyd Dobler, by which I mean they didn't love me, not with their whole hearts, not with their idealistic souls, not enough to hold a boombox up outside of my window in the twilight, playing the song about my eyes that we listened to after we lost our virginity, while the suggestion of a summer breeze teased the long hems of their slouchy brown cotton blend. Have you ever met a man like Lloyd Dobler? A man who moves the glass from your path where it's broken? A man with a mouth that pouts just so? A man that's pined for you from the shadows all your high school years while you were busy studying hard and spending daddy's hard stolen money on responsible purchases, like pens. Or were you in the shadows too, with 30 racks and fire pits, coughing over bongs or American Spirit Blacks, sneaking your best friend back into her house where she broke her glasses and wouldn't have gotten caught if it weren't for that, and the fact that she left again after you were gone and walked her neighborhood singing in a blackout and waking up your first grade teacher and her parents, but at least she didn't say your name when they asked how she broke her glasses. And when they took away her phone, they texted you first to tell you she was grounded, but she could call you once a week. And Lloyd Dobler could never pine for you because he couldn't see you through all those shadows. The men who tried to teach me stick loved me in these various ways, like a sister, which I couldn't understand because I've never been a sister, never had a sibling, never will. Like a best friend, someone they wouldn't want to fuck things up with, they said. Not realizing that the nothing of a decade fucks things up just as much as fucking does, like a best friend they totally want to fuck, but not like anything else, you know. Like my mother, who was not a man, but who tried to teach me how to drive stick on that dirt road, a quarter mile back and forth, popping the clutch and lurching to a halt every time. I never even really switched gears. Even automatic, switching lanes was scary. That's why I don't drive now and haven't in 6 years. Mom would drive us back home and I'd be fuming in the passenger seat and texting my crush, who would never fly across the world with me if my daddy was caught stealing money from old people, which would never happen. Neither my daddy stealing money from old people nor a flight across the world, and definitely not with a man next to me holding my hand so I didn't scream. But I would ride a lonely train from Texas to Vermont and spend a lonely year looking for Lloyd in red cups filled with vodka flavored by Jolly Ranchers and crying in tree crooks and calling my best friend, her voice cutting out because the service was shit, and taking two hits of acid on a bad bottle of wine and waking up in my bed wearing nothing while a boy I couldn't stand reads me James Joyce. I never learned to drive stick. Thank you.
That was great. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
I love the internet because I never would have known you before.
Now I want to hear more.
I want to echo thank you for that, Hannah. That was wonderful. And kind of taking it from Eleanor here, I want to thank you again, Hannah. Thank you, Sam and Jonathan, for this conversation. We'd also like to thank Bradley, John Lynn, Tess, and the rest of the team from MB Art for helping to make today's event possible. As the special projects editor here at The Rail, I just want to share that it's truly been a privilege to bring all of these new and old friends together in the arts, humanities, and science together daily here to share work, points of view, and wisdom. A very wise person I spoke to on the NSE made the statement, the audience is the midwife. So I would like to thank our audience and those that join us so regularly, and a special thank you, GE. Thank you, Lynn. Thank you to a lot of our other regulars here, Umberto, Tasha, Craig, Catherine, Igor, and so many others. Thank you all for joining us today and so regularly. We encourage everyone to view our archive of these conversations on our YouTube channel, where we will upload today's conversation shortly. Thank you for helping us to get to 500. And join us tomorrow at 1 p.m. for our 74th Radical Poetry Reading, curated by Dal Strom and featuring poetry read by Stephanie Adams Santos, Samia Bashir, Shayla Lawson, and Coleman Stevenson.
We have another small tradition of allowing everyone to turn on their mics to say hello and goodbye. So I am now passing the mic over to the audience. And thank you all again for joining today.
Thank you, everybody.
Thank you,
everyone.
Happy anniversary.
Appreciate it.
Thank you, Jonathan. Yeah. Thank you, Hannah.
Thank you. I really enjoyed the
talk, Sam.
Beautiful. Thank you,
Nick. 500 episodes.
Thank you, GE. Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Hi, Lynn.
Hi. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much.
Thank you, guys.
Thank you, Hannah, everyone. For the poetry.
Awesome. Yeah.
Thank you, Hannah.
Huge thank you to Hannah.
Thanks, everyone.
Till then.
Thanks, Sam. You were great.
Thank you. Hey, Catherine. Thank you.
Hey, Catherine.
Thank you, Sam. It was great.
Thanks, Saul.
Thank Jonathan. It was a pleasure to meet you.
Yeah.
Can't wait to see you again.
Yes, Pong we'll sends his love soon. And gratitude and regrets that he couldn't be here to say it himself, but he.
That's good. He needs to be doing other things. He needs to be doing some work.
Yeah. Out of his comfort box.
Here's our great hugger painter.
Thanks for seeing you, Sam.
Thank you all so much.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Bye.
Now go have our lunch.
Okay. Mm-hmm.
Thanks, everyone.
Bye-bye.